Chicago and Louisville, and an adjunct professor in Jewish and Holocaust Theatre, as well as Identity Theatre at DePaul University. His current production, Imagining Heschel by Colin Greer, is about the great philosopher and civil rights activist, Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, and it will be in the upcoming online TEATRON Festival of Jewish Theater, which David is also producing. Right before COVID, he directed the epic drama, Mother Courage and Her Children by Burlock Brett in Louisville. He was dramaturge for Broadway in Chicago Timeline production of Oslo, as well as dramaturge for the Victory Gardens production of Indecent by Paula Vogel. He's also written numerous articles on theater and advised and curated exhibitions, including the first exhibition on the Yiddish theater and New York theater at the Museum of the City of New York. He's on the executive board of the Alliance for Jewish Theater, and he is coming to us from Louisville, Kentucky. David, it's all yours.
Great, thank you so much, Wendy, and thank you for alerting people to how we're going to do this. And I know that people would love to be able to see the screen expanded. Unfortunately, I found that we get into a danger zone if we do that. So thank you for your patience, and I really appreciate it. And I also want to thank the Levy Center for having me. This is my first time here. So yay, first time visitor. And I hope that we can work on doing something else together. It would be great. We're going to go into Leonard Bernstein as a voice for all time. We're going to hit on a few of his areas, but we will not, I need to put this in as a strong proviso, we will not cover everything about this man, about his work, about his background, about his interests, about how he just expanded into every single area that he was a part of. He, of course, came from a Jewish background, and that's one of the things that brought me into it because of my studies of Jewish performance and culture. But he went even beyond that. He went into classical music. He went into Broadway. He went into popular culture. He went into political areas. He went into areas that some people, know him personally as not being so ethically connected to his wife, and also was sometimes not very kind to her, perhaps is a nice way of putting it, but kind of left her hanging at the end of his life, which was at the end of her life because she died before him, Felicia. So we need to acknowledge all of this about the man. The man was a genius beyond measure. He also had faults. He also did things that were not appropriate. And we need to call those out today as well. He also did things that were quite appropriate, not only for the times he lived in because he met those times, but also quite appropriate for today in terms of racial equity, in terms of reaching out to those of color and bringing them in. He was one of the first to feature Marian Anderson, one of the great opera singers, and have her perform with him, and did this with others as well. He was one of the first to reach out to African Americans in equity, and was called out for that, not only by the broader mainstream community, but the Jewish community as well. But that did not stop him. He was a man beyond measure. He was a voice for all times. Now, when we think of Leonard Bernstein, we think of him as being a New Yorker. But in fact, he wasn't just from New York. He was from Massachusetts. He was from the Boston area. He was from and found his home at Tanglewood, Massachusetts, the beautiful encampment of performances and concerts in the summer, where, of course, all of Western Massachusetts becomes this great location for culture. So we're going to take a look at the beginning of Leonard Bernstein. I'm going to go to share screen and let's see a little bit from his beginnings. So here we are with immigrant Jews coming to the United States. And Wendy, if you could just give me a thumbs up to let me know that you can hear this.
Son of Jewish immigrants from Russia, Leonard was born on August 25th, 1918, near the city of Boston. His father is not amused when the youngster announces his wish to become a musician. So Lenny has to pay for his own piano lessons. The 16-year-old plays in jazz bands and likes to party far into the night. He has both an endless number of friends and intellectual interests. From very early on, he fascinates all who meet him.
He had charisma by the bucket load. I can't think of another artist with such personality, such charisma, huge drive, energy that puts anybody half his age to shame.
That kind of enthusiasm and love for what he did, and it all was real. There was not a phony bone in it. You know, people hated the fact that he jumped around. It was all real. That's what.
Okay, so we're going to stop that there. And I just want to reemphasize his beginnings and his background. When he grew up, he often said, you know, there really wasn't that much music in his family. He didn't really come from a musical family. Now, I think that's interesting because one of the first things that got him into music when he was 10 years old was getting an unwanted piano from his aunt, from Lillian Goldman. And this piano was lifted up into their home and brought in, and he just started fooling around on it and fell in love. In fact, one of the great things about the piano was it had a very interesting pedal, which isn't known or done that much today. It had a pedal in the middle that allowed the piano to sound like a mandolin. And he found that fascinating. So not only was he learning how to play piano, he got music lessons, and his father actually in the beginning was very supportive. Later on, he was not supportive of him going into the music business. In fact, what he said to his son was, "I don't want you to be a klezmer." So he thought of, you know, being a musician as being someone who was like an itinerant performer, and the only thing they would do would play it weddings and bar mitzvahs and, you know, the things that klezmer musicians were known for in the old country. But he still, at the beginning, paid for Lenny's music lessons. They were $1 a week, and he was able to do that. But then they started to go up in money. They were like $2 a week and then $5 a week, because not only did he become much better at playing, but he showed an acumen and an ability that went beyond a simple music teacher's ability to train him. And he pretty much was self-taught. And when he attended Harvard University, he studied music with some of the great musicians at the time. And when he graduated in 1939, he in fact went into music right away. He followed the musicians of the time, and in fact was quite upset when George Gershwin died, and stood up in the middle of the Harvard dining hall that he was in and declared, "We have just lost one of the greatest people ever in the history of American culture," and that's George Gershwin. So here I want to play a little bit, and he was a huge influence on Leonard Bernstein, so I want to play a little bit from Leonard Bernstein playing Rhapsody in Blue.
Thank you.
So I want to get to Bernstein playing piano, though, on this. And Bernstein was a world-class pianist and not only was able to conduct and write and compose, but also perform. So here he is playing the beautiful piano interlude in Rhapsody in Blue. I also just want to point out the klezmer lick at the very beginning of Rhapsody in Blue, done by the clarinet. So I'm going to stop that there. We could go on and on, but Bernstein was often compared to George Gershwin because of Gershwin's ability to go back and forth between classical music and Broadway. And also Gershwin went into film music. Leonard Bernstein also went into film music, by the way. He composed the score for the film On the Waterfront, as well as some other scores. But Bernstein, kind of rejected this because he felt like not only was he much more accomplished in the classical realm, and of course being the first young American maestro ever in the United States for the New York Philharmonic, but he also felt like his interests in music brought him into a much more complex relationship to the music. And let me go now to influences that Bernstein had that went beyond, because Bernstein eventually did go to music school. Let me just find the right spot here. And he went to Curtis Music School in Philadelphia. And there he met Dimitri Mitropoulos, who he didn't really study with, but was very influenced by him as a conductor and maestro, and eventually Serge Koussevitzky, and then Aaron Copland. So we're gonna hear a little bit about his influence by Serge Koussevitzky and Dimitri Mitropoulos, and then Aaron Copland.
University, the festival at Tanglewood will play a major role in Bernstein's artistic future. There he meets two
lifelong guiding stars
in terms of conducting.
No, that's about as high as it goes.
Young musicians, Serge Koussevitzky, and the conductor, Dimitri Mitropoulos.
I learned for the first time what a conductor does, how he has to study, and this man was really incredible. He knew everything, and he was incredibly passionate. He had an enormous influence on me. He is in my blood to this day. And I said, what should I do? I'm in despair. And he said, you must be a conductor. I said, a conductor? I said, of course, it's perfectly obvious. How do you know? I know. I said, but I can't conduct. I don't know anything about it. Study with somebody.
Those early encounters were so important. Mitropoulos, in so many other ways, because Mitropoulos was gay and was an outsider. He was Greek. He was never really accepted in America. He understood Mahler before most other conductors in America. He made the first recording of Mahler's First Symphony in Minneapolis in 1941. He was phenomenally energetic. When Lenny got from him his athleticism on the podium, Mitropoulos would jump up and down. He was a very tall man. Lenny was short. And Mitropoulos was really the first gymnastic conductor. And he was an intellectual who read in five languages and loved nothing more than to sit through the night discussing the nature of the universe and the existence of God. Koussevitzky, very different. Very different. Not vastly intellectual, not technically the most accomplished musician, but he is an instinctual and an emotional musician who is able to tap into the deep heart of a Sibelius symphony, for example, in the way that few others have ever done. And so Lenny was able to connect with Koussevitzky's musicianship on a very personal level.
He suddenly said, but of course I accept you in my class. I didn't have to play the piano, do anything. Just on the basis of letters and, I don't know, personal, because we obviously loved each other on sight. And so it was. He became my father instantly. We loved each other, and till the day he died in my arms.
The one part.
So we can see not only was Leonard Bernstein influenced by these great conductors, these great maestros, because of their style, because of what they had to teach him musically. He was also drawn to them because in the case of Dimitri Mitropoulos, he was gay. He was also Greek. He also felt himself to be an outsider to the rest of the kind of WASP establishment in American culture at the time. And Bernstein was drawn to them and fell in love with them. He always talks about how Serge Koussevitzky died in his arms. And he never, ever forgot that. But he also was influenced by Aaron Copland, and they became extremely close friends. And we can hear, I want to play a little bit from a piece by Copland that was one of his earlier pieces. And this is so different from some of the Americanized style of pieces that he wrote using folk music and then bringing in Appalachian Spring or Rodeo. Here is Copland doing a piece called Vitebsk. And this is a town in the Ukraine area of Russia. It's rarely done, but I think it's so powerful and also shows another element that Bernstein brought into his music.
Thank you.
So here we have a piece that is meant to depict a shtetl in Russia, which is where Bernstein's family came from, where Copeland's family came from. And this shtetl, some of you may recognize the name of the town, Vitebsk, if you are knowledgeable about Chagall, because this is where he came from. And Copeland wrote this piece right after a pogrom where the town was ransacked by marauders during a time of tension between Christians and Jews, and many people were killed and people were raped. And so you hear the anxiety, the mournfulness, the brokenness, and the modernness. And this is something that you don't often hear in Aaron Copland's pieces. And I think Bernstein kind of took this and included all of this now, the kind of athleticism of Dmitri Metropolis into his conducting, the grand music of Serge Koussevitzky, who actually was born Jewish and had converted to Christianity, the jazz that was in Gershwin. And finally, you see Bernstein putting it all together into his first symphony, Jeremiah Lamentations, which he wrote in 1943. So we'll stop that there. Sorry for the crawl that's on the bottom there. Who do we see here in the frame conducting this? Here we see Bernstein's great friend, Aaron Copland, conducting a piece called Jeremiah's Lamentation. Bernstein wrote Jeremiah in three movements: prophecy, profanation, lamentation. And I don't know if people caught this, but the singer who's singing is singing in Hebrew. And what is she singing? How doth the city sit solitary that was full of people? How is she become as a widow? She that was great among the nations and princess among the provinces, how has she become tributary? What she's singing is the text that's often read on the commemoration day of Tisha B'Av, the ninth day of Av, the day that commemorates the destruction of the temple. Here, Bernstein is going back to his roots, both in music, bringing in these different forms of both a kind of lyricism and grandeur, but going back to his own Jewish roots and finding the beginnings of what he wants to portray as a Jew who is also in exile. And she sings in Hebrew, she sings about loss, she sings in a sense of mourning, and very similar to what Copland had done in Vitebsk. Now, Bernstein did not just stick with these kinds of compositions. And in a way, this is something that plagued Bernstein his entire life. People thought, oh, he's not really a serious composer. Yes, he's fun to look at. He likes to jump around when he's conducting. He's very athletic, like we saw Metropolis. But he also does jazz, and he also does popular music, and he also does Broadway. In fact, after he left Curtis Institute in Philadelphia, he went to New York and shared an apartment with his friends, Adolph Green, and often accompanied by Betty Comden and Judy Holliday, they formed a comedy troupe. And they called the comedy troupe the Reviewers in Greenwich Village, and they performed at the Village Vanguard. And he even took on a pseudonym so that people wouldn't know that this great classical musician was performing jazz and honky-tonk music. And here is one of his pieces that he wrote under the pseudonym Lenny Amber. So here we have the Honky Tonk Train Blues. And Bernstein couldn't like give up one side of his personality, which loved not only popular music, but a deep connection to culture and identity. He found a home in doing jazz and in doing pieces that were more popular, that were done on Broadway. Here he is with Adolph Green and Betty Comden, and Jamie Bernstein, his daughter, is talking about how they got to know each other. Actually, I think Adolph Green's wife is also talking.
Summer camps were not just initial training grounds for songwriters. Sometimes lifelong partnerships were formed there.
My father was music directing at this camp. It was really his lucky day when this weird, schlubby guy, Adolph Green, arrived to play the Pirate King in Pirates of Penzance.
And Lenny had heard about Adolph through Adolph's friends, how Adolph knew everything there was to know about classical music.
On their first meeting, when my father found out that Adolph purportedly knew everything, he said, "Oh yeah, come over here." And they sat down at the piano, and my father said, "What's this?"
And he played something, and Adolph would say, "Ravel Piano Concerto Number 2. Boom. 2 seconds. Okay. I played another thing. Tchaikovsky's thing about 4. 2 seconds, he knew it.
And my father couldn't stump him until finally he played this one thing. "What's this?" And Adolph didn't know what it was.
And Lenny jumped up, grabbed him, and kissed him. He said, "I just made it up on the spot to try to really screw you."
They were best friends forevermore. And the thing about Adolph is that he had this kind of impish spirit. He had this liveliness and this antic quality. And then when Betty Comden became Adolph's working partner, and she was so lively and quick on the trigger and funny and sassy, the three of them had so much fun together. They really spoke to this zany part of my father.
This monstrous little duet is entitled Carried Away.
Modern man, what is it? Just a collection of complexes and neurotic impulses that occasionally break through.
You mean sometimes you blow your top, like me?
I do.
If they hadn't come along, maybe my father wouldn't have written musical theater, or certainly not the kind of musical theater that he wrote with Betty and Adolph that was so delightfully fun and goofy. I mean, after all, he was supposed to be a very serious maestro.
In the 20th century.
Okay, so we'll stop that there. They get carried away and go off. But I'm now going to jump back to Bernstein's classical side. And I do this on purpose in order for us to see how all of these things were happening in Bernstein's life at the same time. His popular culture and musicianship, jazz, which he actually took very seriously and talked about that on his Young People's Program and also in his lectures about music and what music meant for culture and how jazz was a very serious form of music and was one of the great American contributions and Black contributions to the world. In fact, actually, that's a little side note. They say there are three things that America is known for as spawning for culture. One is jazz, the other is Broadway musicals, and the third is quilting. And I'll be glad to take questions about that later. I'm sure people will have something to say about this. But here at the same time that Bernstein was getting into musical theater, he was doing On the Town with Comden and Green. He also was looking at serious literature and poetry that moved him. And he took a piece of poetry called The Age of Anxiety and by Alden, and took this and found within it not only a poetry of anxiety and living in a modern age, but also something where he still found his Jewishness. Within the poem itself, it says, "For we are his chosen, his ragged remnant, with our ripe flesh and our hats on, sent out of the room, time tormented. But his people still, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." And this is what inspired Bernstein then to write his second symphony, The Age of Anxiety. And we'll play a snippet of that right now. And from that movement, I just want to move to this other section, this very grand movement within the Age of Anxiety, which also shows the kind of grandeur that Bernstein started to incorporate into his music. So here we go about here. Thank you. unfortunately, we have to end that there. There's so much to it, and it's so beautiful at the end, and also this sense of longing, and yet this great grandeur going from the anxiety and then moving forward into a sense of hope and yet still questioning. And this is something Bernstein continued to do, not only in his music, but in himself and in questioning the world and what kind of world are we living in and how is this world becoming a better place. And here we see it also encapsulated in the work that he did on West Side Story, which a lot of people don't know the backstory behind that. The backstory to West Side Story is also interesting. We'll hear a little bit about that right now. Let me just find the spot.
As the Broadway musical matured after World War II, and issues like bigotry and racism were no longer entirely off limits, director Jerome Robbins began working on a show called East Side Story that featured a conflict between Jews and Gentiles.
Jerry Robbins came to Lenny Bernstein and me to do a contemporary version of Romeo and Juliet. One or the other was to be Catholic and Jewish, I forget which. And what finally happened was I realized it was AB's Irish Rose set to music. That was an enormous hit in the Dark Ages with a Catholic girl and a Jewish boy. And so we dropped it.
East Side Story was transformed years later when the creative team found a way to project the fears and tensions of assimilation onto a new group of immigrants. With a score by Leonard Bernstein and lyrics by a 27-year-old Stephen Sondheim, the show musicalized the conflict between white ethnics and Puerto Ricans finding their way in America.
Lots of new housing with more space.
Lots of doors slamming in our face.
I'll get a terrace apartment.
Better get rid of your accent.
Life can be bright in America.
If you can fight in America.
Life is all right in America.
If you're all white in America.
That's something that has made the show more timely today than it was then. When the word immigrant is said on the stage today, you can feel the whole audience freeze because of all this, I won't characterize it, stuff going on in Congress about immigrants. It's a nation of immigrants, which we are very busy trying to deny.
My father never gave up on the idea that the world could become a better place, but he struggled with it because all these ghastly calamities kept happening in his lifetime, starting with World War II really being the big one, and then the bomb, and then he went through McCarthyism, which was so evil. So all the way through his life, he was constantly doing whatever he could to make the world a better place. Racism, not the least of these evils that he was trying to repair. And I really think he felt somehow that if he wrote a great enough piece of music, he could change the world. And you can really hear that struggle in West Side Story. It's about intolerance and hatred and the misery that that sows in the world.
Somehow, someday. And this moment in West Side Story where they come to the end, often people think about the end of Romeo and Juliet, but this is also a time of atonement, a time of an accounting for the sins of the world, for the inability to accept the other. And this is something that Bernstein cared very much about. And Jamie Bernstein depicted it very well when she talked about that, about how if he worked hard enough, if he could write a piece of music that was the right piece of music, he could change the world. He truly felt that his work was there and that he was here in this world to make the world a better place. And we say in Judaism, the phrase tikkun olam, to repair the brokenness of the world. Now, the idea of accepting immigrants, as Arthur Lorenz talked about, and people should know that the four people who really put it together were Leonard Bernstein, Jerome Robbins, Arthur Lorenz, and Stephen Sondheim, people who created Broadway in a new way, taking on ethical issues that had not been seen before. And here we have Bernstein taking on the show of Candide, a story that goes back, that's written by Voltaire, about a man who's hoping to find the best of all possible worlds and goes to the philosopher Pangloss and says, can you tell me how I can find the best of all possible worlds? And he keeps traveling from place to place and country to country and getting beaten up, and the women that he falls in love with, get them getting raped, and him trying to make money and it all falling through. And then him going to an Inquisition and being tortured by the inquisitors because he's not Catholic. And here we have the very wonderful song that is done by Patti LuPone and Candide in this concert version of the show called I Am So Easily Assimilated. Bernstein, once again, taking what Lorenz said about immigrants, and how is it ever possible to fit in if you're always deemed to be the other? Sorry. That pops up every once in a while. You have to kind of restart it, but we'll get there. Okay, here we go.
I was not born in sunny Hispania. My father came from Rovno Dubernia. But now I'm here, I'm dancing a tango. Day-dee-day, dee-day-dee-day, I am easily assimilated. I am so easily assimilated. I never learned a human language. My father spoke a high middle Polish. In one half hour I'm talking in Spanish. Por favor, Tariador, I am easily assimilated. I am so easily assimilated. It's easy, it's ever so easy. I'm Spanish, I'm suddenly Spanish. And you must be Spanish too, to like the natives do. These days you have to be in the majority.
Tus labios rubi, dos rosas que se abren a mí, conquistan mi corazón y solo con una canción.
Mis labios rubi, they feel that I'm not racial.
So we'll stop that there. But here, Patti LuPone, ironically, is talking about how easy it is to be assimilated. But the reality is it's not. And that people keep seeing her and others as outsiders and not accepting those who aren't like them. So I want to also emphasize another aspect of Bernstein too, which is Bernstein as a teacher. Bernstein came from a family of great learning, of great Jewish learning. His father was a Talmud scholar. And in fact, he took that very, very seriously. Jamie Bernstein writes, "There's a Hebrew phrase that makes me think of my father. The phrase is Torah Lishma. Loosely translated, she says, it's a raging thirst for knowledge. It literally means studying the Torah for its own sake, that's the highest mitzvah, the highest commandment that you can have." She says that Bernstein had this about everything. He could absorb everything and he could use his learning to convey a new sense of inspiration to the next generation. So let's hear from the great conductor and maestro, Michael Tilson Thomas, talking about the first time that he met and then lived with the Bernstein family.
Appointed music director of the New York Philharmonic, and a generation later, a father and son relationship similar to that between Koussevitzky and Bernstein was to develop between Bernstein and a young Californian, Michael Tilson Thomas.
I first met Leonard Bernstein after a summer in Tanglewood, where I was a fellow, and I would have been around this time 22 years old. It was in the late 60s, early 70s. It was a particularly difficult time because my main mentors and teachers in California, Ingolf Dahl, Gregor Piatigorsky, had become ill or passed away, and I was really kind of in a rudderless time, needing someone wise to talk with. And Lenny and Felicia and indeed his whole family sensed this and really drew me into them and kind of adopted me. And on the holidays, Thanksgiving, Christmas, big holidays, I would spend time with them in the country or in New York. And these were very, very great times of great Scrabble games and walks in the woods and cooking good meals and very witty conversation and just great fun. And also many hours in which Lenny and I had a chance to sit and pore over scores together and really talk about the musical issues behind them. And I have here an old score from that time. In fact, it says here, Connecticut 1970, so Christmas. And this is a score of the Schumann Third Symphony, one of the first big pieces I talked with Lenny about. And we sat down, and right away he said, "Look, you have to have a sense of priorities in any piece you work on. What are the composer's priorities, and what are your priorities? And how do these two things interrelate? How do they fuse? How do they complement one another? Because everything in music, everything is kavana, this Hebrew word that means intent. I've got that written right here, big in my score. So what are your intentions at the beginning of the Schumann piece? What do you think Schumanns are?" And very often in Schumann symphonies, conductors discuss the question of the texture, because it can be a very muddy texture. You sometimes hear Schumann openings that go something like this. Murkiness. And he said, "You must dispel all of that without changing anything actually that Schumann wrote. So you must articulate it. You have to arrive at a text for it. Give me a text. Make me a lyric that really expresses what you feel about the Schumann Third Symphony, the so-called Rhenish Symphony." So I began improvising, and together we sort of arrived at this lyric, which goes like this. Reine, oh du schöne, schönste Reine, schönste mehr als Heinrich Heine, und nicht wäre, ich bin deine. And he said, "Great, now that you've got that swing, you can begin to think how you'll make that happen in the orchestra."
So here is Bernstein teaching a young Michael Tilson Thomas, which some people may know also comes from a very strong Yiddish theater. His family were major leaders in the Yiddish theater. Boris Tomaszewski, that's his grandfather, and Bessie Tomaszewski, his grandmother. and he's teaching Michael Tilson Thomas how to approach a piece of music. And he says, you must have kavanah. Once again, drawing on his own identity and then expanding it out in order to engage with the music in a textual way. He said, you must have text. And this is what people learn when they learn together, that learning is about engaging, is about grappling, is about wrestling, is about having questions. And Bernstein was able to continue that throughout all of his music. He was asked to compose a new piece of music for the Kennedy Center when it opened. Let me see if I can find it here. Here we go. And, you know, to ask him to do that, of course, was a great honor. But then what does he choose to do? In interesting and yet funny and yet very appropriate way, Bernstein combines all of this and creates his own mass. But this mass is kind of a counter mass because it's a mass that is questioning and that is wondering whether we're living in a period of time where we're actually living up to the ideals of what he felt Kennedy stood for and what he felt democracy and America stood for. And he uses, once again, going back to the Psalms, going back to the beginnings for him of his musical roots. So here we'll hear a song, a beautiful song that I'm sure many of you have heard before, called A Simple Song.
Welcome to the Disney Bundle with Disney Plus, Hulu, and
close that for a second. Sometimes YouTube does that. We'll skip and go right back to it.
Blessed is the man who praises him. Lauda, lauda, laude. And walks in his ways. I will lift up my eyes to the hills from whence comes my help. I will lift up my voice to the Lord, singing loud aloud.
Okay, we're going to end that there because we're coming near the end of our time. But here he goes directly to Psalm 123. I will lift up my eyes to the Lord. From where comes my help? In the Hebrew, Esa Enai El Heharim Me Ayin Yavo Ezri. Where comes my help? Where comes my salvation? A very simple song, in a way, kind of playing off of his friend Aaron Copland's using 'Tis a Gift to Be Simple, and then making it not only melodic, but also in a discordant style, bringing in what we heard earlier from the age of anxiety, taking melody, taking anxiety, bringing them together and asking the question, are we still making the world a better place? So I'm going to end on that right now, on the final song from Candide. What is the purpose of life? What is the purpose of all of Candide's wanderings? It's to make our garden grow.
Take a few modest little acres and build a small farm. And casting aside all vain speculations as to the meaning of this meaningless world, we will fulfill our function, working God's earth from dawn to dusk.
You've been a fool, and so have I, but come and be my wife, and let us try before we die to make some sense of life. We're neither pure nor wise nor good. We'll do the best we know. We'll build our and chop our wood and make our garden grow and make our garden
Any questions?
So we'll get out of stop share. And as Pangloss says at the end, any questions?
That was lovely. Let me come back on screen. Let's see. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to come back on screen and I'm not able to do that. All right, let's get to some of the questions.
Sure.
David, thank you. That was really comprehensive. Can you talk about, it was great to see his daughter, Jamie, speaking so candidly and with great emotion. Can you talk about his family life? You mentioned before that, he's gay, he was a gay man who was married. Was he close with his children? Was he?
Oh yeah, very close. In fact, I have a clip also where all his children are together. I didn't show it, but they talk about how they were with him not long before he died and he wasn't doing well. And then they went down in the hotel that they were in together at near Tanglewood and went down to the bar, and he hadn't been feeling well. He hadn't been able to really do much at all. And then he saw the piano and he went over and he played Rhapsody in Blue. And his son, Alex, said this was the most beautiful moment that he had had with him. He played it more beautifully than ever before. And Jamie and his other daughter, Nina, also were all very close to him. And yes, it was difficult for them. I don't know that much about, how they felt about the relationship that he had with his wife. He loved her very much. As we were talking about this yesterday, he came back after she got ill. She had cancer and he took care of her. And even though he had gone off with some other people and he kind of did his own party thing and was not responsible in his relationship to her, yet he still felt not just connected to her, but loved her very much and loved his children and maintained that throughout his entire life. And they speak about that today. Felicia goes around and does talks about it. And I think she even came up to Ravinia on the 100th anniversary of his birth and spoke very movingly about him and about his work. And so, yeah, it's definitely was not, something that was his finest moment, no. And yet he was who he was.
As a father, he was correct?
As a father, he was, as far as I know, loving, caring, involved, beautifully involved with his kids, as much as anyone who's a great person in demand can be, but he was very involved in their lives, yes.
Okay. Donna would like to know, did his father live long enough to see his son's success?
He did. He did die early on in Bernstein's life, but he did see his son's success and he accepted the fact that his son had become a great musician. He still had not just questions about it, but really didn't think it was, a profession that his son could be in, and that it was a moral profession, an ethical profession, which, to some extent he had some appropriate concerns about. And yet he did see not only the success, but you know, they kind of, even though there wasn't an actual rift, there had been a distance between them, and they pretty much reconciled near the end of Sam's life. So yes, but it was not easy. He was much closer to his mother and to his sisters. To his sisters, he was very, very close. Shirley, I think, is one, and the other I can't remember. And they were all very, very close, and they all loved each other very much. And he makes a point of saying that he was not as close to his father at all, and his mother, he was, but there still was a distance. It was hard for them as immigrants to this country to accept, you know, the ways that he could be part of a society and also live the life that he lived. Yeah.
Evan has a question. Did homophobia affect Bernstein's music as well as his political passion for the underdog?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think that he was both careful, because he didn't want to kind of come out publicly. At the same time, you know, so many of the artists that he was involved with, from, you know, poets and writers and composers, Stephen Sondheim, Jerome Robbins, Arthur Lorenz, I mean, all of these people were gay. They were also Jewish. W.H. Auden, I mean, others who weren't Jewish as well. But still, they had like a little bubble of a community that, and in a way, this is what Broadway did for people who were gay, for people who were Jewish, for people who were in theater, who were African-American. They often got jobs, especially during the McCarthy era, when they got blacklisted because of being on the red list, they could still get jobs in the theater. So Bernstein was very involved with that community, very involved in the civil rights movement as well. And that, in fact, got him more into trouble. He got into trouble when he had a big party in his apartment and invited people from the Black Panthers over to his apartment to have a fundraising party for them. And he got lambasted, not only by the American press, but by Jewish organizations, and saying, how dare you invite, you know, people who are, you know, saying that the, you know, burn baby burn, and, you know, it's similar to the things that people say today about Black Lives Matter. So Bernstein, you know, was out on the limb in so many ways, but never let up in those things. He still championed causes that were anti-war. I saw him conduct in an anti-war performance that was done at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C., when America went into war against Cambodia. And it was a brilliant performance and so powerful. And I'm sorry to say, I can't remember the piece that they did. And one of my friends, in fact, my band teacher was in the choir. And he said, you know, people asked him, what is Bernstein like? What is it like to be under his baton? And he said, during rehearsals, he was so intense. He had attention to every single detail. But then in the performance, he was just all over the place. So, you know, his exuberance and his passion would always be there in the performances. And this was something that he often got blamed for as well. And people would say, you're not a serious composer. The music that you write is too performance front forward. You need to create something that's much more serious, like Aaron Copland, or, you know, others that are writing, Lucas Foss, who are writing music in a much more serious or, you know, analytical way. But that wasn't Bernstein. That wasn't who he was. And people still loved him, despite all of these different ways that, you know, there was something about him that turned you off a little bit, but then there was something more about him. He was so embracing. He just loved people. He would kiss people, you know, just on meeting a stranger, give them a huge kiss. So He was expansive in every single way.
Okay. Did any of his children try to be accomplished in the musical world?
Yeah, Jamie did. Jamie was a folk musician, and she actually sings quite well. And in a way, she reminded me of Joni Mitchell. Every time I would hear her perform, and she had a lovely voice. Just like anybody in the arts, I know this firsthand. You're not always going to be the most famous celebratory person. That doesn't mean that she wasn't accomplished. She was, and plays a beautiful guitar and has a lovely voice. So I don't know about Nina, and Alex, I don't think is, no.
And the three children are still alive.
Yep.
What sparked your interest in Bernstein?
Sure. Well, for me, first of all, growing up in the 60s and 70s, and not only seeing him in the Young People's Concerts, but being attracted to the music that he did, to the Broadway music that he did, to West Side Story, and me being in theater and also a singer and also a cantor, this kind of brought it all together for me. And Bernstein, exemplified not only a Jewish figure who could make it, but it wasn't about making, it was about being who he was. His authentic self never really left him, even though sometimes he would, kind of pull it back. He wouldn't come out so much publicly until near the end of his life about being gay. Nevertheless, he was who he was, and it all kind of came together. And then being such a polyglot in all these different forms of music and performance and writing. I mean, the man spoke five languages. He was brilliant. He read constantly. He gave incredible lectures, of which you can see so many of them now. They're on YouTube, philosophical lectures, lectures at Harvard, the Norton Series lectures. It's just amazing. And you were asking me the other day, I was trying to think who is like him today. And I can't think of really anybody. In theater, I can think of someone. I would say Tony Kushner. Tony Kushner has that same expansive knowledge and expansive quest for knowledge, and will not, he just won't be quenched. I know Tony Kushner a little bit, and I interviewed him, and he just can speak about anything for hours and hours and hours. And that's the same with Bernstein. So, that would be my comparison today of who is like him in the arts today.
Okay. Do you know, did he ever pursue psychotherapy?
I think so. I don't know that much about it. I've read a few biographies of him. I don't think they get into that in depth. I think he did go into some therapy around, his split from his wife, but I don't know if he went into it in an ongoing way or how serious that was. So I can't really speak that much to that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anything else? I know you have to leave at 2:30 to teach your next class.
I do, I have to teach.
So. Is there anything, any last thought you want to leave with us about this remarkable man?
Yeah, I mean, there's just so much more. I took a class that I put together for six sessions and combined it into what we talked about today. And we went into a really deep dive into his classical music, into his jazz music, into obviously the Broadway side and his relationship with Jerome Robbins, which was quite strong. And the two of them worked consistently together. The two of them worked on a number of versions of On the Town and Wonderful Town, and then a ballet based on that as well. And then they were going to work on another ballet on the Dybbuk, which is the Jewish kind of story of a demon that enters into a young woman. I mean, they continued to work together throughout Jerome Robbins's life, and they were very close. And I think, you know, this ongoing expansiveness is kind of the thing that and his questioning, always questioning. He said something in one interview which I loved, which is that a teacher and a musician are the same. They're engaging with the material as if it's happening right there in the moment. And it's as if they're encountering the music or the text fresh and new, and it should always yield surprises. And the surprises should lead to more surprises. And then those, we should be surprised, the teacher should be surprised at all of the surprises. So never stop being surprised, always be in the moment. I mean, this is, I think, an incredible way to teach teaching. And you can go through the lectures and talks that he gave and come up with pedagogical tools that I think are, you know, so important for any teachers today. This is something that I try to do as well, is try to approach any subject that I do as if it's new. Even though I've taught about Bernstein before, you should know, Wendy, I prepared a lot for this today because I wanted this to be as fresh and as new as if I was doing it, you know, for the first time.
Absolutely, I have no doubt. And it's, you know, you presented a fantastic program. We've gotten oodles of compliments thus far, and it was exciting. I knew very little about him, so I appreciate the overview that you've provided, and you've certainly left enough breadcrumbs so that people who are interested in following up can go to YouTube and, you know, look for these clips to watch them in full. They can listen to the symphonies. There's so much available without leaving your, you know, leaving in front of your device that we can all take advantage. And, you know, a tape of this lecture will be on YouTube and on the Foundation's YouTube channel this evening. And I just thank you so much. It was so fascinating. And I know you have lots of other programs that you, you know, you're excited to talk about. Can you give us just a little taste of some of the ones that you...
Well, I do, and just finished doing a 6-week course on klezmer music, which goes into Jewish music of all kinds, but mostly related to East European Ashkenazic music, but also going into world music as well. I also have a class coming up on Alan Sherman, which I like to do popular culture and entertainment and comedy as well. So, and then going into things that are much more serious based about the ways that the Holocaust is represented through theater and performance, the impact of Jews in American theater and performance, and also about how our identity is so important to not only present to the world, but then how is that done and how do we do it so that it brings people together as opposed to being divisive. And that's so much a part of my most recent play that we filmed, Imagining Heschel, about the great Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, who is not only a great philosopher and theologist, but also a great civil rights activist and worked strongly with Martin Luther King. In fact, when King would say, "Get my rabbi on the phone," everybody knew who King meant. It meant Heschel, and Heschel had died too soon. At a very young age.
You mentioned you're developing a course on women comedians.
Oh yeah, I have that. I've done that many, many times. I'm just teaching it again on Thursday to my class at DePaul University. And I'm bringing in a good friend, Michelle Slonim, who's a comic performer in New York. And we're going to do some shtick together, so it should be fun.
Okay, so we have lots to choose from. We won't be able to have you back for 6 weeks in a row, but another 90-minute session is absolutely.
That's great. Loved it. Okay, good being with you all.
Thank you.
I gotta run. Okay. Bye-bye, all. We'll be back in touch. Good seeing you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Next week, we will have an art historian talk to us about the paintings of Frida Kahlo. It's going to be fabulous. I hope you can join us. Thank you so much. Thank you, Levy Senior Center Foundation. We couldn't do it without you. Have a great week, everyone. We'll see you next Tuesday at 1 o'clock.